George Klein, Memphis Sounds, Elvis special. Back in the day, I did an award-winning interview with Scotty Moore, his guitar player, and DJ Fontana, his drummer. It took place in Studio B in Nashville. It won a telly for the cable interview of the year.
One threw a party in the county jail. The prison band was there, they began to wail. The band was jumping and the joint began to swing. You should have heard your
in Jailhouse Rock, Scotty, we all knew those songs were great. It wasn't like the songs from Love Me Tender. The songs from Loving You were pretty good, but Jailhouse Rock had some killer songs in it.
You're so young and beautiful. You're everything I love.
If you don't want me to be cold as ice, but treat me nice.
Now, there was a scene in the movie, Scotty, where you were wearing sunglasses or something. You remember that?
Yeah. That's
again, maybe I don't care.
Maybe I don't care. Is again. What happened on that? We were filming outside in the
Swimming pool.
By the swimming pool, and in all the close-ups were done in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And then after lunch, they set up back behind the pool for the long shots. And the sun had come around by that time. It was coming in on the little bandstand we were in. And I had all my sunglasses. Of course, the girl that's supposed to continuity, she missed it, and I didn't even think about it myself. She should have come told me to take them off, you know. Now when you see it, when they cut to that long shot, you see little black eyes, and then all of a sudden it's close enough.
Okay, I'm ready as I'll ever be. Stand by, please. Everett, demonstration number one, take one.
What was it like in the studio with Elvis, in the recording studio? I don't mean exactly Sun Records, but once you moved over to this wonderful studio we're in today, it has so many memories here, RCA, Studio B, this has to bring back a lot of great memories for you.
Well, he still wanted everybody in a pile.
Now explain, DJ.
Well, you know, I don't think we got them. They had the baffles, and that would segregate everybody. And he said, move that damn thing. I don't want that thing over there. Move this over here. I don't. Get the guys in a pile here.
You want to record live, per se.
Live, per se.
Burn me up this time. Let's see if we can get a little fire in. Try it again, sir. All right, stand by. Everett, demonstration number two, take one.
Okay, now, when we got to the movies, the songs that were to be used in the motion picture, did you guys have input on that? Or when Elvis got to the studio, I know he didn't like to rehearse, and he liked everything fresh.
He never rehearsed.
And would you guys say, well, Elvis, I don't know about that song, or Elvis, maybe we ought to skip that song. How did that work, Scott?
No, we didn't get involved in that. We might tell him, dude, we got to do that piece of crap there.
Some of the tunes were pretty good, and he had a keen ear for picking material.
Now who wants to buy a heart?
Oh, yeah.
One broken lover's heart. One broken heart.
There was a situation in Columbus, Ohio. It's midwinter. It's cold as heck. This guy who looks like a tackle for the Green Bay Packers comes in with a T-shirt on, and he throws
Toledo.
His billfold down on the table.
Toledo.
And can you guys pick up the story there?
This big guy, he's a big old boy. And back then, you know, the Levi's, the Suriettes and the T-shirt, and it was cold as hell outside. And Elvis was coming down the elevator, so I ran out and got him. I said, hey, come on in, this lady's gonna do Love Me Tender. He says, okay. So he came in and sit out, and next thing you know, this big old boy comes in. He said, you're Elvis Presley? I said, yes, sir. He said, I come here to whoop you. I said, for what? I don't even know you. Sit down, I'll buy you a Coke, and we'll talk about it.
Why don't you run along, Sonny, before I muss up your hair?
He didn't want to hit. It went on and on and on. So I got up. Bill got up next on the other side of Elvis. And I said, Elvis, get him. I said, he ain't that big.
Bill on the other side. Hit him.
I said, don't take that. But you don't have to take that, Elvis. I said, punch him out. I said, he's not that big. He's a big old boy.
Yeah.
I could see his hands were just shaking. He was so mad.
Elvis's hand.
He was just going like this.
He had a lot of nervous energy.
Yeah, and I kept saying, don't take that stuff off him. He's not that big. We'll help you. Well, the guy went to swing. Scotty jumped on his back. We threw Scotty over the bar rail. And that made Elvis mad. And he must, I don't know how many times he hit that guy.
The bottom line, guys, is that Elvis could handle himself when he came to fisticuffs.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he was good at it.
Not only in movies, but he could duplicate it on the road if the real thing came along.
Lightning fast.
He could hit you 10 times, and you didn't know where he was coming from.
What floor, buddy?
When you throw Elvis's shoes away, or
that's him.
When you throw his shoes out the window, and Elvis is wearing my shoes.
Yeah, I throw his shoes away. Yeah, you know, you work on the road for 7 days or 2 weeks actually, and them old socks get rank after a while. And he'd, like a fool, take his shoes off, put them down neat. Yeah. You know, I said, So as soon as we get out, I make sure we was over at Rivers. He'd be asleep. I'd get him, throw him over the river thing. And he'd wake up and said, let's get something to eat. Where's my shoes? I said, back down the road. So we got to go back and get them. I said, well, we can't go back and get them, Elvis. They're down the Mississippi River.
Here, put these on.
Where are you going?
I'll be back in a minute.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Hey! Nuts. Absolutely nuts.
In the late 50s, I'd say 56-ish or 57-ish before he went in the Army. When we were on the road, I would be traveling with Elvis in one car, but you didn't travel with us. Why was that?
Because of when we get where we're going, there's going to be a crowd waiting for him usually at the hotel or anything. And we tried to divert around that and go on and do our thing.
So you were sort of a decoy?
No, he was a decoy. Oh,
well, Scotty, why did Colonel Parker put the band in one hotel, Elvis in another?
That was our
choice again.
Oh, it was your choice?
Yes, sir.
Now, why was that? All the girls were with Elvis.
Well, sometimes.
Come on, everybody, and whistle this tune right now. Come on, everybody, and stomp your feet real loud. Come on, everybody, take a real deep breath and repeat after me.
Where did Elvis's dancing come from on stage?
I think he learned it from the gospel people. You know, they used to dance and
the
shout.
Black entertainers, maybe?
Yeah.
And, the Drifters, Clover Splatters, Jackie Wilson, those guys.
I just think he picked a bit up here and a bit up there and a bit up, you know, just everywhere.
Because Elvis always said he didn't like an entertainer when he would go see one who would just stand there and play the guitar and sing. He thought you had to give him more of a show.
Well, he was right. Yeah. Yeah. He did.
And how did that affect you guys on stage? Because it was hard to follow him in those early days, Scotty. They didn't have those sophisticated stage monitors and the earphones. And
the minute you took your eye off, and you were lost.
You don't know any dance steps that I knew.
Tell us about how Elvis started shaking his leg at the opening Park show. It was a Slim Whitman show, maybe?
Slim Whitman was the headliner. So anyway, we go on, and he's playing guitar, and the girls started, especially down in the front row, they started squealing and carrying on. Then we did the second song, same thing happened. We go off, and he said, "So where are those girls? What's the matter with them?" And what it was, most guys standing up playing a rhythm guitar would stand flat-footed, pat their foot, keep them tight. Uh-huh. He'd go up on the balls of his feet like this. And in doing so, he's balancing and playing rhythm at the same time. I mean, it looked like a covey of quail in the bushes.
Everybody in the wholesale block was dancing to the tail out of rock.
And that's what got him all excited.
So that's how it originated, so he parlayed that into part of his whole life.
Viva, viva, Las Vegas!